All right, 1 Peter 23. 1 Peter, the 23rd verse, says this. It's right there. I want you to take a look at it. This is the Message version, so it's like contemporary. Trust me, you'll feel it, the whole message, if you stick with me. Your new life is not like your old life. Your old birth, you'll love this. Your old birth came from mortal sperm. Look at your neighbor and say, which version is that? I grew up on King James. I didn't know about sperm. That's what the Message version says. As soon as I saw that, I was like, man, got to preach it. Your new life doesn't come from mortal sperm. No, just your new birth comes from God's living word. Just think of it. A life conceived by God himself. Coming by way of question all across the world, do me a favor, and I really mean it. Touch at least 5 people and ask them, who do you think you are? Who do you think you... I said 5, that's 3.5. That's 4.25. I said 5. Who do you think you are? Go ahead and take your seats. I'm an avid sports fan, as most of you know. I love the Browns, I love the Cavs, even the Guardians, anything Cleveland is Pastor Vernon. You will never see me repping another team. 0-16, I'm wearing the Browns. I did wear the Browns. 0-16, tell me somebody else in Cleveland who did that. I'm Cleveland all the way through, but I do have other players whose game I admire. They play with a kind of heart, kind of competitiveness that, believe it or not, I try to mirror in my pastor. One such player is Kevin Durant. Kevin Durant, and whatever else you think about him, no one denies he can ball. Trying to find his way in terms of what team he wants to play for. Wish I had 10 minutes with him to sort of speak into his life on maybe what's missing. What are you searching for with all this team jumping and social media back and forth with persons you don't even know? I would love to meet him because I can sense a good heart. But there is this one thing he said that made all of us who are athletes or want to be athletes almost run out of our house. Some reporter was doing a back and forth with him about how some player who was average at best, decent defensive player, Patrick Beverly, had been locking him up for a couple of games. They thought the reason why Kevin hadn't scored was because this average player, decent at best, he would even tell you, decent role player, had a decent game against Kevin Durant. And the question that was asked to Kevin Durant was, do you think you can handle Patrick Beverly? He responded in a way that I shall never forget. He looked at the reporter and said, you do know who I am, don't you? You know who I am, don't you? I'm Kevin Durant. Now, many of you may look at that as arrogance. I looked at it as honesty. The question that begs asking this morning is not so much does Kevin know who he is, but this morning, do you know who you are? Thank you, team upstairs. When the enemy comes to you, are you aware and cognizant of who you are and whose you are? When the devil tries to play you, you should say, I'm Keisha. Y'all just missed that. I'm Darnell. You know who I am, don't you? I belong to Christ. And therefore, there's a certain way I carry myself. Come here, singles. There's only a certain person that I date or even consider dating. There's only so much I'm going to put up with because I know who I am. The question this weekend to every person watching is, do you know who you are? This morning, Pastor Peter sends us a theological text that really deserves some explication because it is in 1 Peter that he says something that blows me away. And do me a favor, it's just one of those Sundays. Sometimes I'm narrative, and sometimes I'm topical, and sometimes I'm just strictly expository, and do not apologize. What does expository mean, future preachers? To expose the text. To just go verse by verse. Expository preaching means you let the text talk. You don't have a lot of in-between conversation. You go from one verse to another and just let the text talk and let the Bible do the preaching. So I'm just kicking it on the West Coast this past week and thought I knew which way I was going. All of a sudden, I'm in my morning devotion. I come across this and the Holy Spirit says to me, as clear as I'm speaking to you, that's the word for the weekend. And so I called what I call this pastoral audible and found myself just enslaved to this text, married to it. Over the last 7 or 8 days, verse 1 opens up by saying something amazing, because Pastor Peter tells us and tells us who we are right away, and you may not like it. Look what he says in verse 1. He says, an apostle of Jesus Christ to those who reside as aliens. To those who reside as aliens. I said, did he just call me an alien? To those who reside as aliens. I'm like, not to those who are blood bought, washed believers, to those who are saved, sanctified, and Kentucky Fried. That's not what he said. He said, to those who are aliens, I thought about the time warp between me and the outsiders and some of the millennials and even Generation Z. Those of you who are about my age, remember the 1986 classic called Aliens? Aliens, remember Aliens? It wasn't that cute, not that pretty of a picture to look at. And then I thought, whatever else the Word Church is going to be cold-blooded at, it is this intergenerational preaching. So I see like 50 teenagers that are looking at the screen like, what is that on the screen? So since you don't think past alive, what about Stranger Things? And now all the old people are lost. Because my daughter stayed up to 3 o'clock in the morning waiting for the new episode of Stranger Things. Her and all her friends stayed up. I'm on the West Coast, they're on the East Coast, waiting, and Stranger Things broke the internet. Literally thousands, millions of persons watching Stranger Things. Whether you want to use aliens or Stranger Things is still what I mean. The scripture calls us aliens. Peter said to the aliens. The scripture also calls us pilgrims, come here, and strangers. Strangers, millennials, Generation Z. In other words, there should be some differentiation between us and the average person. Now, that almost sounds like an insult, but Peter said to the aliens, those of us that saw somebody coming down from Mars or somebody that looked like that ran up on us, we'd be like, who is that? In a very real sense, it's my job to preach the text. And the text tells me that we should be like aliens to some people. Some stuff about how you carry yourself should be so foreign to people, you're almost alien-like, alienated. Yeah, you feel alone. You feel like you're the only person that doesn't have a tattoo on your butt that says born to die. I'm sorry, 16 of you got a tattoo called Born to Die right on your butt. I am so sorry. Again, I'm dealing with this thing now, and it's a summer kind of series. It's a summer kind of sermon. If I was training pastors, I'd tell them, but there's something kind of cool you want to deal with, kind of deal with it like July, August when everybody's gone, and save your heavier stuff for when everyone gets back. But I do want to say this. There's like this series I'm tripping on, and I need you to help me name it. YF, are y'all here? Young followers, outsiders, kind of like Christ versus culture, or when Christ collides with culture. Culture meets Christ. I mean, I really want you to help me name it on Facebook. It's where I think I'm leaning, and we're gonna do like all the graphic stuff and the creative stuff and make it like a fun series, but yet it'll have depth to it, because can we all just be honest? It's hard right now to be saved. I know some of you say it's not, but those of you that want to be honest, I'm not talking to those of you who want to play games, but as a young woman, how hard is it to dress saved? Yeah, let's go here. Because on the one hand, I'm single, and bros do get turned on by what they see. At the same time, the Bible tells me to dress in modest apparel. When I dress modest, they don't look at me. When I wear certain things, I get a few more looks. As a married woman, I'm called to be a modest woman and wife of God. On the other hand, my husband likes me when I kind of wear that. So I can't wear what I want, but then I can't wear what I should. And so it makes me feel like whatever else I was telling Lady Vernon, we have to err on the side of Jesus. And say, even though it may not make sense, some stuff about me ought to be different. Some stuff about how I carry myself ought to be alienated. I shouldn't fit right in. There ought to be some people that's waiting on me to leave the club. And when I say club, wherever you may be, not so much a club, but someplace where everybody's hanging out, and it's like, I can't wait till she leave. We can't really start stuff because she's so Jesus. She's so God. Oh, here come Miss Church. Look, do me a favor. Look down your neighbor and say, show is. Go ahead and tell somebody. Okay, watch what he says. Verses 3 and 4 says, what a God we have and how fortunate we are, shout when you feel like it, to have him, the Father of our Master, Jesus, because God has given us a brand new life. We have everything we live for, including the future in heaven, and the future starts now. Watch this. What a God we have and how fortunate we are to have him, our Master Jesus. He was raised from the dead. We've been given a brand new life. I want somebody to testify in this crowded church that you're getting ready to act brand new. Tell somebody, I'm all brand new. Go ahead. God has gotten a hold of my life. And so the first thing that Peter gives us, I want you to write it down, is our peculiar position. Our peculiar position. Our peculiar. There's a peculiarity to believers. Something about us is different. We have this position where now we're in Christ. We are saved. It's peculiar to some people. We've been brand new. We've been made alive. And don't you ever forget, no matter how the devil bombards you with demonic thoughts, who you are and whose you are. And Pastor ran back from a real quick 7-day break to preach to you this morning that in spite of everything I'm watching on TV, in spite of everything I'm seeing on social media, you got to know who you are. You got to know who you are. Cannot run from that. You'll see what I mean. So now the reason why I need to know our peculiar position is so that it can help me. Here it is. Write it down. Our prescription for present pain. Our prescription for present pain, because I don't care, look at me, I don't care how saved you are. Most of you are going through something in the present. Do you want a scripture? Let me ask you again, do you want a scripture? Here's what the Bible says, you'll love it. Verse 6 says, I know how great this makes you feel, even though you have to put up with every kind of aggravation in the meantime. Now, what I just said should have made somebody run. I told you. I knew you would fall in love with this text if I just read it to you. I know how great this makes you feel, even though you have to put up with every kind of aggravation in the meantime. Now, I want you to catch this. In the meantime. Now, I know how great. What makes you feel great? The prescription. The prescription is I'm in Jesus. The prescription is I'm saved, sanctified. The prescription is I've been bought with a price. So I have to take my medicine and know who I am to put up with the sickness of this world. So the text says, no matter how much you love God, no matter how much you have, come here, eschatological hope, which means I know where I'm going. I know that when I die, I'll be with Jesus. I know that heaven is my future home. But in the meantime, I'm dealing with some stuff. I don't know, I came to preach to some people that love Jesus. But in the meantime, I'm dealing with some stuff that's trying to really mess with my mind. In the meantime, one of my children is not what you think, Pastor. In the meantime, these relationships are getting on my nerves. You ought to thank God for Jesus Christ of Nazareth, because here's a double entendre, double entendre. Sometimes it's some mean times in the meantime. I'm gonna try this one more time. It's some mean times. In the meantime, you better go to some other church. I'm never standing on this stage. Not me. The next guy, next young lady, whoever can do whatever God tells them to do. But while you're on my watch, I'm never standing on this stage and not deal with the relevancy of what's happening in this world. How can you get on stage and not see the uprising of this nation right now? Everything from gas being $19.76 a gallon. That's just a bit of hyperbole, that's all. Just a bit of hyperbole to a Supreme Court decision that has our nation divided in half, to people getting shot by the tens every day, so much so you don't even trip no more. Let me say that one more time. I said, stop me when I'm lying, that people are getting shot in mass shootings so often that you don't even trip no more. There was a time when one mass shooting would have shut down the whole nation for 3 weeks. There would have been something at the White House, a mourning period. Now it's just like going to lunch. Guess what? 25 people got shot in Cincinnati. 10 people got shot at the grocery store. 25 people got shot at the movie theater. And the enemy is so rampant right now, and the saints are so busy trying to be cute, we not praying. The saints are so busy trying to be fashionable. The saints are so busy trying to get followers on Instagram. The saints are so busy trying to fit in with the populace that the Lord told me to come prophetically today to tell you we got to pray in the meantime. Because I know this is old school, but there is power in prayer. I wish I had 10 people that believe that God said, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then I would hear from heaven and heal their land. I wished I had somebody watching that knows it's time for the saints to pray and say, God, we need you right now. There is so much happening. In the meantime, can I tell you that the test of your faith is not so much your eschatological excellence, but how you meddle through the meantime. It is how you handle life in the meantime. Anybody can shout when things are perfect, but somebody on your row is dealing with something, and God sent me to church on this hot summer day to tell you, let's have church to praise him in the meantime. Y'all miss that? Can I get 50 people that life is not perfect right now, but you made a cognitive choice this morning that you walked in here with your mind stayed on Jesus, and even though I know one day I shall see his face, what you gonna do in the meantime? I wish I had somebody that understands that you have a prescription. Your prescription is your position. Okay, this is gonna tie somebody up. Unless you stick with my sermon, you're gonna miss it. Your prescription is your position. The only prescription you have is your position. Your position is postured by your prayers. So that when you pray, knowing who you are in your position, whoever die, whoever cheat. Oh, I don't play preach, I just preach. I don't play preach. Whoever play you, whoever betray you, whoever walk away from you, whoever disappoints you, it'll hit you with a blow. You a bent. But you won't. Do me a favor, hit somebody and say, I'll bounce back. Go ahead. That's the wrong person. Say, it may bend me, it may twist me. And depending on the gravity and gravitas of the relationship, it may throw me, but because of my position. And so during my journal time, I do like text journals. There are two things I do during my prayer time. If God puts you on my mind, I send you a prayer text during my war time. I send a prayer text to whoever God drops in my mind. I send them a prayer text 5-6 in the morning. If you ever get one, don't be mad at me. But if God drops you on my mind, I just pray into my camera and send you a prayer text. That's just part of my routine now. But I also do some prayer journaling. And one of the things God told me during my prayer journaling time, and catch this, he said, I want you to prepare yourself to bounce back from the worst day of your life. Now, what I just said is worth $1 million. Have enough Jesus in you. Have enough God in you. Have enough pneumatological nuance, Holy Ghost, inside of you, that whatever happened on any given day, it may crush you, but it won't kill you. Y'all not hearing me. You got to get yourself ready for bad news. You got to get yourself ready for some bad news, because if you keep on living, I hope that's why you like the word church. If you keep on living, some bad news is coming. If you keep on living in this world, and God positioned me that I have so much of you that nothing that happens will make me smoke weed. Nothing that happens will require me to go get drunk. Nothing that happens will have me contemplating shooting myself. Just let me be sad and that's all. Just let me grieve. But Lord, you be a fence all around me. Lord, guard my mind. Lord, here's the Bible, keep me in perfect peace because my mind has been stayed on you. If you're like 25, 15 years old, 13 teenagers, you're going to wish you had heard this sermon. I've been preparing myself for nearly a quarter century for the worst news of my life. And I don't know when it's coming. I don't know when it's going to happen. But I've been preparing myself like some bros in the gym hitting them weights, like some girls working on their figure or Instagram models or bros working on their game. I have been spiritually preparing myself since I was 15 years old to handle the worst news a man could get and not go crazy. That's the best sermon I've ever preached, and you don't know it yet. I am telling you that God told me to tell you, don't wait till life happen. The worst time to look for God is when you need him. Not only, so the prescription, watch this, the prescription is our position. The prescription is our prayer, but then the next verse tells us, you'll love this, the prescription is in our praise. I'm gonna show it to you. Because the Bible says in verse 8, just one of those Sundays is what God told me to do, expository. Verse 8 is on the screen, look what the Bible says. And therefore we praise him, you'll love this, with joy inexpressible. And although you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now but believe in him, you greatly rejoice. Watch this, it's shout time, with joy inexpressible. I'm sorry, let me try one more time. With joy inexpressible. Did I tell y'all 2 weeks ago I'm going to deliver y'all from slow if it takes me 10 years? With joy inexpressible. Okay, if I say something 6 times in a row, that means I'm looking for something. With joy inexpressible, full of glory. So the prescription is in my praise. Watch this, because my praise is so crazy. God is so good to me. I don't have enough semantic structure, vicious vernacular to tell you how I feel. So I do stuff like, okay. Y'all just missed that. Whenever you see somebody waving their hand, whenever you see somebody running around the church, do me a favor, hit 5 people, say, I can't explain it. Go ahead. That's the wrong person. That's the wrong person. I wish I had me some praisers watching me all across the world that would shout in your house and say, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me and the world can't take it away. Can I get somebody on this side of the church to jump up on your feet and go to praising God like he gave you another chance? Joy. Favor. Hit 3 people, say, you don't know me like that. Go ahead. You don't know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know who I used to be married to. You don't know who I got a child by. You don't know what my mama didn't do for me. You don't know how God has kept me my whole life. And when I come to church, I'm not worried about what my neighbor thinks. I can't have it. Yeah. Inexpressible. 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 Clothes on my back. Inexpressible. Shoes on my feet. Inexpressible. A roof over my head. Okay, so. Yeah. seconds and give God an inexpressible praise. Woo! What's up? What's up? Why y'all all standing up? What's up? Why are all of you standing up? Oh, you must have just had a flashback. Look at your neighbor and say, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all, okay, now, he's done for me. Okay, give me some volume in the house. Give me some volume. Give me some volume. Look. Let me just say this. She's shouting toward the wall. She's just looking at the wall shouting. I need some people to just turn your whole body to the wall and praise God by yourself. I need you to forget about everybody in this room and just think about how good God has been to you. And your could have been me, but God. I was texting back and forth with my new white brother from another mother, Pastor Rich Wilkinson from VU Church, and we've been since he came to our gathering. He just was so overwhelmed by the love and the facility that he just like hit me up every week. And I was telling him how much I'm learning from VU, and he was telling me how much he's learning from us. And if I were to tell my beautiful brother something, our white brothers and sisters do some things to me culturally. Resources, number one, that's real, afford it to them, allow them to do some things more out of the box, and can't wait, we're doing some of that stuff here. But one of the things the black church does better than anybody is express. Because when you are a people that was wounded by marginalization, still behind the eight ball, still fighting, when your own constitution calls you 3/5 of a person, and when you were called boy at 50 years old, it was the black church that allowed you to walk in on Sunday. And no matter how laborious the week had been, when you got to church, that was the one place you can let it go. And can I tell you, in the tradition of the traditional black church, I know some of you are bourgeois, and to all of you upwardly mobile Negroes who have 6 degrees now and 10 jobs, if it had not been, I feel like, I wish I had somebody that may have 2 degrees, make 6 figures a year, got a nice house to live in, but if it had not been. Oh, ah! Y'all making me rush. My uncle, Pastor Stewart, who helped raise me, his son is being installed as pastor in Youngstown, Ohio, in Alpha and Omega Baptist Church. That's a name, ain't it? Praise God. Amen. And so my wife and I got to shoot down there and help install him tonight. So I got to go a little faster. I'm going to get some kisses before I go, though. But let me just finish this up, because can I tell y'all this, and I'm going to let you go? Our position is our prescription. Our prescription is our praise. But then Pastor Peter tells us about our preparation. Our preparation. I'm just in the text. The text says, so prepare your minds for actions and exercise self-control. Very seldom do I just lean this far into Eugene Peterson's message version. I'm more of an NASB, NRSV, more of a scholarly translation when I'm working. But that said, I know what God told me to keep it simple. It's summer. So we'll unearth some of this at a later time in terms of Greek vernacular and structure. But right now, just trust me that Eugene Peterson is close when he says, so prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. While I'm there, let's just read verse 14. Don't lazily slip back into those old grooves of evil. Doing just whatever you feel. You didn't know any better then. Those watching, you didn't know any better then. You do now. So part of my positioning, you'll love this, in terms of prayer and praise, is also my preparation. So that's why all my guys, all you that belong to me, my guys, throw your hands up, all my guys. Yeah, we meet this Tuesday. Need you to be on. Since some of you are traveling, need all my guys, every one of you on the Zoom. You're not on the Zoom, you're telling me you quit. If I didn't hear from you, you're not on the Zoom, you're telling me you quit, because I'm not playing. If you're going to let me raise you up as men and the kind of men, then I'm holding you accountable. So I would have did it in person, but because many of you are traveling, I need every person, all my guys that I'm raising up, I need you on the Zoom this Tuesday night at 7. But one of the things I'm doing with you, and I see young brothers looking at me, and that is, I'm preparing you. He says, prepare your minds. Prepare your minds. Put the scripture back up one more time. Prepare your minds. I want them to see that. Prepare your minds. When I say prepare your minds, so prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. How are you trying to control everybody else and can't control yourself? Do me a favor. All of you that are parents or spouses or supervisors, and it's your job in terms of occupation or vocation to tell others what to do, I'm sorry, bump somebody and say, tell yourself what to do. I don't believe you should control anything until you can control yourself. It's been almost 2 weeks since I've looked at any app on my phone other than ESPN and whatever. Because I'm just in a season where God is speaking. I want you to hear me. And what he's telling me to do in terms of our new sports ministry back there. And just remember, I told you this, wait till you see what our new gymnasium is going to look like and all of that in terms of, you know, new floor, just everything for sports ministry, getting, you know, all this soccer stuff. God bless them 10 years. It helped us with our resources and finance, but now all that's gone. And so this beautiful building, those who don't live in Cleveland, who has a sports facility? Pastor Rich Wilkerson from Boo Church, every time I took him to another room, he almost fainted. And he's from Miami with all kind of facilities. He had never seen this kind of facility, and he can't get it off his mind. He'll tell you, wow, the potentiality of that kind of facility that has not quite been maximized, but it will start in this fall. It will. I need you playing volleyball. I need you old people walking around the track. I don't care. Just get your butt around there. You're not dead yet. I need intramural hoop. I need 6 and 7, 8 years old with their jerseys on playing on Saturday mornings against each other. I need our ladies playing, and so you'll see. But in terms of preparation, right now, I can't afford to hear other people's opinions. You're gonna love this. I'm a learner, but right now, God told me don't watch nobody, because it gets in my spirit and makes me miss my assignment. So there are certain seasons where I have to go zero dark 30. LeBron is not the only one. During the playoffs, he goes zero dark 30. LeBron doesn't watch any social media during the playoffs because of the kind of focus he needs. Some of you, God has you in a season of focus. You don't have time to look at her purse. You don't have time to worry about nobody else. This is such a critical time for you. Every time you're not praying, you got to be working. When you're not working, you got to be writing. When you're not writing, you got to be reading to your children. I focus on it, and I still feel like I'm off on the reading to my little girl. I feel like I'm off. I'm the pastor, and I feel like I'm off. So I'm making time, more reading with her, more putting God. I'm training thousands of people. Do my two small children know God like they should? So I don't have time. And God said, prepare your minds, exercise self-control. I'm not looking at that, man. I want to give you something God gave me. These are practical things. It's July. It's like everybody gone anyway, except all y'all. Praise God. Amen. But listen, the Lord told me to tell you this, practical things. If you don't give me something practical, then why do I come up in here? Here's something practical. I was in the airport. We were on the West Coast on vacation, all that. So I red eyes, all that. We're in the airport, and boom, and we had a minute. And God told me to tell the church. I said, God told me. When I drop his name. God told me to tell you, every member of our church is to download the Bible app. Every member, teenager, don't do it now, the Bible app. I know who has it already, raise your hand. If you don't, whenever you have a minute, the world, when your plane's 30 minutes late, or you're waiting in the doctor's office, or there's a moment, me included, every one of us, even when you're waiting on the waitress to come, let me just see what's going on. Use that time and look at your app. I'm not telling you to abandon Instagram. Some of you make money on Instagram. Please use it. It's paying you. It's building your brand. You need it. Social media platforms. I'm not going to be the dinosaur. You need to delete all the apps. That's where the world is. The young people don't even watch TV. If I have any chance at preaching, I got to preach to this phone you're looking at, or you won't even see me. We're not going to be the dinosaur church. What's wrong with Facebook? What's wrong with Instagram? It has good and bad like TV and radio. It is how you utilize it. I am saying to all of you, sometime, and remember Pastor said this, you got 10 minutes, read Ephesians. Of which I have all of my young guys and my elders and my ministers and my elders in training reading right now, the book of Ephesians. Read 1 Peter as I'm preaching today. Read Message Version, NLT. I'm wrapping up. Oh my goodness, I'm out of time. All I'm trying to tell you is prepare your mind. God and scriptures and spirituality is not just going to jump on you like Corona. You gotta let it in. Build your mind. When you see me up here preaching extemporaneously and using words and quoting scripture, I've been working on this a long time. What is it? Prepare your minds. I'm so mad at myself. I gotta stop. Ray, I'm at the mall yesterday. Shamir is here. Shamir does all my little VF clothing and shoes and all that. So I'm always at the mall with him now because we're trying to build. And I'm not trying to sell anything. I'm just trying to, for myself, you know, my own branding, things like that. Whole nother subject in terms of what God is telling me about how more black people than white people bought Mercedes-Benzes last year. Because when you've been marginalized, symbols you feel give you status. So I'm broke with a purse. And I'll take my whole stimulus check for one bag that makes me look wealthy. When real wealthy people, you don't even know who they are. Y'all just missed that day. But I'm saying that to say, and I know I'm all over the place, am I boring you?
No.
I'm sitting there, so you couldn't make this up. The girl from Dallas, oh my God, I'm trying to creep. Boom. Young white guy and his boys walk up to me, 9, 10, 11 years old, young people. He walks up to me with a bag full of candy. He got Skittles. He got Twix. He says, sir, can I offer you some candy? He got Twix, Skittles, all kind of candy. I said, man, you on your grind. Now, I don't know if his mama bought a box of them and he gonna get paid off of them. But I thought to have that kind of entrepreneur mindset, to be walking around, got me thinking about my kids, got me thinking about all of you on how he lives in Strongsville probably, but his mindset is at 10, 11 years old, I'm trying to get my own money. And so I pull out and buy Twix and Skittles, and I wanted to bring them today to hold them up and forgot. But the big point is preparing himself entrepreneurially already. Between your spirituality, your vocationality, your money, your spirit, I'm finished. You don't have time to play right now and watch everybody else. And if you my age, you running out of time. You got to get focused now and say, my past is my past. He gone. She gone. They gone. Pastor, but I blew so much money. It's gone. Forgetting those things that are behind and straining in the Greek, straining. I'm out of time, so I'm gonna stop. Don't lazily slip back. Don't lazily slip back. Don't go back to that. I'm gonna redo this because I've been up now over a half hour. That's all you can handle. So I'll cut some off. But then he says, our purity. Not only our preparation, we've been positioned. We position ourselves through what our prayer and our praise, right? Because we understand who we are. We know who we are. We position ourselves through our position of our praise. But then there's our purity. Because this is old school holiness preaching in my last 3 minutes. And that's this. As obedient, verse 15, children, let yourselves be poured into a way of life shaped by God. Teenagers, watch this. A life of energetic and blazing holiness. Come here. I've never heard that. Teenagers, hey. Hey, hey, what's up? Watch this. A life of energetic, a life energetic and blazing with holiness. This is a whole nother series. Praise team, we're gonna kick it with this because who told you you have a monopoly on holy? What does holy look like? What does purity look like? Because I'm from the church, and to me, the real holy people. How you doing? Praise him. All white, hat, stockings you couldn't see through. You don't know about that. Somebody told me I go to a holiness church. I said, which one is that? Because I need to join. Hey, Ralph, where my son? I was tripping because my son, Ralph, listen, brag on your children, get you a mic. I got the mic. I'm telling you that my son, Ralph, gives me more energy. He's giving me life. I used to trip on having him late in life. Now it's the best thing I did because I had no idea how much him and Lil Victory are giving me life. They're giving me energy. And I want to put that scripture back up because I want to end with it. Look what it says. It says, watch this. It's on the screen. Put that scripture back up one more time. It says, a life energetic and blazing with holiness. Now, a life energetic and blazing. So how come holiness can't be fly? How come holy can't have some swag to it? How come holy gotta be corny? Which makes people who are artsy not want holy. Okay. Some of you who are thinkers can tell God is tripping with Pastor, which is why I gotta get in a room with you artsy people who dress different, who just have a different way about yourself. You get bored with normalcy. It's not that you're not godly, you just got flavor. Yeah, some people just jeans and a t-shirt. You're gonna put on a other shirt just cause you can. You just like the, you just got something to you. Nani, I see you, Nani. You can be older with flavor. Nani, Drita's mama, I love Elder Drita. Just always dress with that flavor. It's not an age thing. Who says that holy gotta be corny? I gotta ask you this, it's the only thing I have, and I'll just cut the rest of my sermon off. Are you boring holy or blazing holy? Some of y'all just boring. I wouldn't want your Jesus. I go to the Word Church. I don't drink, I don't smoke. I wear the same thing every week. I never change anything. I'm not knocking people who have their styles. I am just saying to all of you, there's a generation of people in our church. Culture meets Christ. I need y'all to help me, praise team. I'm finna form a team. Y'all don't believe me? Let us know if you wanna be a part of it, where we get in a room with ideas and write on the freaking wall and just say, okay, Pastor, here's what I'm tripping on. I heard you Sunday. If you wanna be a part of that, I mean that. You better find us because I need people to help me see or help me say what I'm seeing. And what I am asking myself is, how come culture impacts Christians? How come we can't be the livest church in the country and Christianity impact culture? So that bros in the streets trying to be me. Girls in the street are like, what's up with you? Cause you don't wear nothing tight, but you cute. Your clothes fit you cute, but you ain't never trying that hard. And you seem happier than my friends. And you ain't even got a man. Cause there's something about the way you carry yourself that says God got a hold of your life, but he didn't take the you out of you. He took the bad you, but he left the good you. He left the creative you. He left. I'm done. Common sense is just telling me to stop. I wish I can give you this last point, but I promise. I've been doing this 20 years. Y'all through. Let me just tell y'all this. So I'll leave out my other stuff. It'll be another sermon, because I promise it's more than that. But it just went lower than I thought. So let me tell you this. So who do you think you are? Do you know who you are in Christ? Peter sends us a theological text message to explicate to us the criticality of knowing who you are and whose you are. When you know who you are, you'll act a certain way. When you know what he did for you. When you know what he did for you. When you know what he did. Okay. So we'll leave the sound off upstairs. We'll leave the sound off. But we're on the Pacific Ocean. And just one of those bucket list trips I wanted to do with my family, my kids and their spouses, and my baby kids. So we went, you know, we in L.A., Malibu, on the Pacific Ocean, and got this little house for a few days. It's just my dream trip where we had our own beach. I just wanted to just enjoy it. So we out there, and we'll just show you. So I'm barbecuing on the 4th. First time I spent July 4th out of town. And they playing football, Ray and Ralph. And Jason, my son, was quarterbacking, but he wasn't doing too good. Cut the lights back up. And so I said, my sons need me. He was doing his best, but Jay just wanted to read the Bible and all that. So I'm like, I'm going to have to go quarterback. So I left the grill and Ralph, all that. So here's what y'all don't know. The ball kept going in the water. Their hands kept getting wet because they tackling each other and cheating like they do. And so... Come back to me, because I want y'all to see this. So y'all wouldn't believe this. Every time the ball would get wet, y'all not gonna believe this, my sons, both of them, unconsciously walked up to me and start wiping their hands on my shirt. I'm finished. Not only that, they took the ball with me standing there and wiped the ball. And they're not even paying attention. They're doing it sub or unconsciously. They both are taking their hands every time they get wet and walking up to me like I'm a tile. I'm coming. They wiping the ball on me. They wiping their nasty hands on me. And I ask myself the question, who do they... Who do they think I am? Then it dawned on me, there's not another man in the world that my two respectful sons would have the unmitigated gall to take their dirty hands and wipe it on his shirt without asking him, and take a nasty wet football and wipe it on his shirt. Then it dawned on me, except their daddy. Can I tell you what Jesus lets you do? He lets you take all your nasty stuff and put it on him. You took your sex. You took your ex-husband. You took your drinking days. You took your strip club days. You took your cussing days and wiped it on him, and he took it all. Do me a favor. Ask five people, do you know who you are? Woo! Yes. Yes. Do you think you are? The unusual audacity. The unusual audacity. The unmitigated gall to just wipe their hands on me. And while they're doing it, I'm just looking at them. They argue with each other and wiping their hands on my shirt. They going back and forth, and literally they just wiping their hands on my shirt. They taking the football, and I'm just standing there. And as opposed to saying, that's not my dirt. I just took it. I never even reminded them that they were wiping their hands on my shirt. They had the comfortability to do that. because of who I am. I'm their father. And they thought to themselves, Daddy's not gonna mind if we put it on him. Jesus told me to tell you, whatever you've been going through, whoever you used to be married to, whoever you've been in the bed with, whatever you shouldn't have put in your body, this morning from Cleveland, Ohio, God told me to tell you to put it on him. He'll take it all. Put it on him. If anybody has something you need to put on him, you need to bum rush this altar right quick. If you came with a friend, you better bring that friend to this altar fast as you can so they can put it on him. If you're watching all across the world, there's a number on your screen. You can text it right now and put it on him. You can't handle it by yourself. Who do you think you are? You're a son of God. Christ wants to save you. Run, run, come fast. Run if you're here for the first time. I want you to run up here. God is calling you. Put it on him. If you're watching all across the world, put it on him. Who do you think you are? You're bought with a price. You're the beloved. You're the righteousness of God. You're the head and not the tail. You're blessed in the city, blessed in the field. You're God's righteousness and the righteousness of God. You are children. You are the elect. Who do you think you are? Next time somebody asks you that, say, I know who I am. Who do you think you are? I can't have your number. That's why you can't have my number. Because you don't know who I am. No, I know who I am.
If that word blessed you, consider giving to our ministry today. The number is at the bottom of the screen. You can text to give. Or if you want to receive Jesus Christ or just join a church or just receive prayer, text the number below now. We are waiting to connect with you guys. And while you're at it, like and subscribe and share this video, and we'll see you next week. Have a blessed week.